सदाशिवसमारंभां शंकराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वंदे गुरुपरंपरां। माय नमस्कार्स टू ईच वन ऑफ यू गुरुबांधवास। इट्स इंडीड अ हॉनर टू बी गिवन दिस टास्क ऑफ गिविंग एन इंट्रोडक्शन टू द टू पार्ट लेक्चर सीरीज बाय श्री वेंकटरामन ऑन द बुक थॉट्स फ्रॉम द गीता by Shri Jnananda Bharati Swami. My other inadequacies were probably overlooked because I hail from the village Melmangalam, with which Shri Swamigad was closely associated for more than 50 years, and I also had the fortune of having his darshan frequently during my childhood. I'm thankful to the organizers for giving this task to me. What makes Sri Swamigad so special to us, the Guru Bandhavas? Guru Bhakti, Guru Seva. He is a shining star amongst the Guru Bhaktas of Sri Sringeri Sharada Peetham. He served our Parameshti Guru, our Paramaguru, our Guru, Jagadguru Sri Abhinava Vidyatheetha Mahaswamigad. And he also had the fortune of having his darshan of Jagadguru Sri Bharatitirtha Mahaswamigad in his Tilak days. So he had served 4 Jagadgurus of the Peetham. He served by sharing what he learnt at the lotus feet of our Jagadgurus. What did he share? He shared the enlightenment he received by the abundant grace of our Jagadgurus. Paroksha Jnana is possible not by reading scriptures or not by being a scholar, but only by being a Guru Bhakta and receive the grace of a Guru. He received that in abundance, and he shared that with lesser mortals like us through his books. His books serve as a gateway for anyone to understand the magnificence, the splendor, the glory of our Avachinna Guru Parampara. His books are a must for every devotee of Sringeri Math. His books on Sri Chandrasekhara Bharati Swamihad are a guide to understand the incomprehensible Jivan Muktavastha of Paramahamsa Ji Jagadguru Chandrasekhara Bharati Maharaj. His books, translations of our scriptures from Sanskrit to Tamil or English, will always be deceptively simple and lucid, but they will be precise and impeccable, a delight to a scholar as well as a layman. Guru Seva was his life mission, and during his leisure probably he served as a lawyer also. I don't know how being a lawyer helped his family, but I know being a lawyer gave him a language that is unparalleled. The precision with which he defines the subtle concepts of our philosophy, and the way he logically establishes our theories, are a delight to a scholar and an eye-opener even to an atheist. Sri N. Venkatraman, my friend, is a senior counsel, now an ASG. Only a lawyer like him can appreciate fully his books, Sri Swamigad's books. He is an unflinching devotee like Sri Swamigad. And like Sri Swamigad, he is also a lawyer, and he has also chosen to serve our Avachinna Guru Parampara as his life mission. Let us listen to Sri Venkatraman What else can be more enchanting to us, the Guru Bandhavas?
Shankarupena marchittam pankikritam abhutyaya kinkariyasya samaya shankaracharyam ashriye prahlada varato devo yo nrisimha paro harihi nrisimhopasakam nityam tam nrisimha gurum bhaje Shri Satchidananda Shiva Abhinavya Nisimha Bharatya Vitan Nitindran Vidya Nitin Mantra Nitin Sadatma Nishtan Bhaje Manava Shambhurupan Sadatma Dhyana Niratam Vishigepya Paran Mukham Naumi Shastreshu Nishnatam Chandra Shekara Bharati Vivekinam Mahapragyam Dairyodharakshama Nidim Sadabhinava Purvam Tam Vidya Thirtha Gurum Bhaje अज्ञानाम चान्नवीतीर्थं विद्यातीर्थं विवेकिनाम सर्वेषां सुखतम तीर्थं भारती तीर्थमाश्रये विद्या विनय संपन्नं वीतरागं विवेकिनं वंदे वेदांत तत्त्वज्ञं विदुशेखर भारती
ऑफर दिस टू टॉक्स एट द लोटस फीट ऑफ Jagat Guru Sriman Abhinavidyadita Mahaswamigal, our Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam, Mahasannidhanam Jagat Guru Sri Bharati Tirtha Mahaswamigal, and Sannidhanam Jagat Guru Sri Vidushekara Bharati Swamigal. They also seek and invoke the divine blessings of my Manasik Vedanta Guru, Jnananta Bharati Swamigal, but for whom? But for the grace of Mahasannidhanam and the blessings of Jnananda Bharati Swamigal, I would not be able to utter even a single word in Vedanta. Like last year, we were fortunate this year also during Navaratri to visit Swamigal's Adhishthanam at Mannadi Mangalam, placed the book Thoughts from the Gita at the Adhishthanam, sought his blessings, and with the divine grace of the Acharyas of this Peetam, and my Manasika Guru, I would like to utter very, very few words on this encyclopedic description of Bhagavad Gita captured just in 140 pages, of which these two talks will cover about 50 pages of that book. People in Chennai and people all over the world who have relatives in Chennai would have all seen, heard, discussed, been concerned about how Chennai was drowned in through the rains for the last 1 week. Is it not baffling for us to say, a young mind which always probes, a young mind which always wants answers ready-made, an young mind which always wants visual experiences to be the basis for truths. We are asking a question to those young minds. Why not the brilliant brains in this world regulate those rains? Why should Chennai drown? Why should all of us be suffering from a pandemic for the last 2 years? If human genius, if human minds, if human intellects are so superior, so invincible and powerful, why haven't we found solutions to the various problems impacting this universe? When we put this question to a young mind, it bounces back with an answer. Well, there are many questions which cannot be answered. That's one way to answer it. Some say, well, it's all nature. You have to live with it. That's a reality. We are visualizing it. Yeah, we are not able to do it. That's fine. So we get responses from these young inquiring minds, answers of these types. So let's probe a little further and ask to ourselves one thing, whether they agree, whether they like it or not, there is a tacit acceptance of a fact which all of us have to necessarily join with, is that we are tacitly admitting that everything is not within our control. I mean, to that extent, there is consensus. Whether we believe in God, we don't believe in God. Or when I say non-believers, people who are born in this soil normally cannot be non-believers. Their tendency to oscillate, which is so natural and inherent in any human being. So, the question which we will take up for discussion today is, Swamigal, Jnananda Bharati Swamigal, whose 132nd Jayanti got over on the 6th of November, who has authored this book along with various other books in Sanskrit, English and Tamil, seeks to explain, see, this book was written 60 years back to those young minds at that point of time. And therefore, whoever reads this book, even after 500 years, it will be fresh and captivating for any young aspiring mind who wants to know about God. Now, what does Swamigal do? He paraphrases and puts a question. Are we accepting the fact God exists? Or are we saying God exists everywhere? Are we saying God exists within us? Are we saying God exists outside us? Be it as, no problem, whatever we may think about it. The logic which an young mind wants to know is, if you say there is an existence of God, then he should be more powerful than human beings. If you are going to say God is going to be like us in another form, then God is like us. So he is no different from us. So God cannot be like us. That's ruled out. So the other two possibilities are, God doesn't exist. That's easier to say because I don't see him anywhere. The third possibility is, God exists and God exists everywhere. So between these two, between these two extremes, there is no God, but God exists everywhere. What does our philosophy, our dharma, speak for and on behalf of the whole world? See, these are all sacred texts beyond a particular religion, beyond a particular community or any people. It is available for those men and women across the universe who are competent, capable, interested, and ready to pursue under the guidance of a spiritual teacher. These are all common texts. These are all wealth for the universe. One such text is Bhagavad Gita. Now, he takes this question and says, puts it in seven compartments to logically pursue stage by stage to prove that God does exist. And just not the fact that God exists. God alone exists and God is all pervading. I think that's the point which we need to logically show to our children. God is somebody who is all pervading. So if I'm able to demonstrate and show that there is a force which is all pervading, then possibly young minds may agree to say, we will call that energy or that force or that nature as God. So this next 50 to 60 minutes, the journey will be in only explaining how there is something which is all pervading. Now, what are the sources through which we can know God? That's the first question. Okay, you are saying God, you are now going to take us into a logical journey of all pervading power of God. What are its sources? That's something which we need to define. So, what are the sources to know about this all pervading God? The sources, the author chooses it as three. All the human beings, the human race, puts it under the bucket called jivas. Then this whole material universe, the world around us, which impact all of us, as the second bucket. And the cosmic forces, which control, regulate, monitor, and shape this universe in its daily routines, as the third bucket. And logically tries to explain that God is someone who pervades all the three. Unless he pervades all the three, then, Bharat, it looks like my audio is not coming out. Now, the author chooses to logically drive home the point that God is all-pervading. So the question is, what are the sources he chose to prove that God is all-pervading? He has chosen three. The first bucket is the entire human race, irrespective of the continent in which one may live, and puts it under the bucket called jivas. That is no discrimination on gender, religion, race, continent, nothing. The whole of the race, jivas, is put in one bucket. Now, the second bucket the author chooses is the whole universe, the material world, which impacts all of us and makes us to respond or makes us to contribute. That's the second bucket. And the third bucket is this, the various cosmic forces or the energies which regulate, monitor, and then run this universe in its daily routines and in an order. Because Bhagavad Gita says, the whole of nature works as per my order. And what does the author do? He takes those statements, those declarations, those affirmations said and stated by Bhagavan Sri Krishna in his 700 verses, takes those quotes, stimulates it with certain illustrations and examples, and finally tries to conclude, God should be somebody who should be all-pervading, which means he should pervade the entire human race called jivas, the entire material world called this universe, and also should be above the cosmic forces. So, if we are able to logically show there is one energy which pervades all the three buckets, so we are not gods as jivas. In terms of Vedantic principle, each one is nothing but a god. But as a jiva, stuck with this body, mind, and intellect, where the jiva is captured in it as a prisoner, we are not gods because we have limitations. We are not all pervading, something which we need to concede. So show us an example, show us the energy which pervades the jivas, the entire material world, and the cosmic forces. Now, first we will take the material world, the second portion, namely the universe. And the author divides this universe into two parts. Material things which are tangible in nature, the computer through which I speak, the device through which you listen, the chairs on which you are all seated, these are material, tangible things. And also takes the energy within these materials which holds it. Let's take the case of a stone. A stone is held, a mountain is held as a mountain or a stone because of the strength of the hardness inherent to it. When you consider the case of a fire, we see the form of fire which is very visible, but the heat or the warmth which it produces is intangible. You are able to get that flame because it generates that heat. So you see light and also heat. Heat or the warmth is only something to be experienced and felt. All of us know electricity. We know that electricity passes through a wire. Though not tangible, we accept that it's electrical energy which enables various apparatus in this world to work. So he takes these two parts. The visible, tangible part of the material world and the intangible part which supports it, which allows it to make it work and impact us. And says, look here, I'm going to now show logically that God is somebody who pervades all this. All right, how does he do it? He now takes the first step and says, let's take this example. Can God be defined as somebody who is someone who has enclosed everything within himself? Isn't that way to define him as all pervading? So let's take a simple example. We take a rod or we take a wooden plank and we are able to box that all around. So we are covering the whole wooden pipe on all its four sides. All on its six sides. Now, can we therefore say, because the wooden pipe is within that enclosure, it is able to come into contact with that enclosure at all its points? That's the first test he puts it. And concludes the answer is in the negative, because a wooden pipe is rested into an enclosed wooden box, but doesn't mean that iron pipe has come into contact with the entire enclosure within which it has been housed completely. Like darkness, like light, does it permeate, invade, touch, come into contact with every part of that wooden enclosure? Ask that question to yourself. You will clearly give an answer, no, it doesn't come into contact. So the first test is God is in the form of an enclosure. Is he all pervading? Means he is enclosed everything within himself. Can give rise to this serious doubt that does he touch all the points, if you go by the logic of an enclosure theory. And cites the following shlokas, chapter 12, shloka 3. The Bhagavan says, he stands enclosing all, within whom all are all beings. And in chapter 9, shloka 6, know that all beings are in me, as the great air and space ever pervades all things. So, if you pursue the logic of an iron rod being put in an enclosed wooden box, we are not going to reach the logic of proving God is all pervading. It's not going to happen. So this has to be discarded. Let's take the second step. Is God somebody who occupies, can we say, Okay, don't take the example of an iron rod. Take the example of a box. Insert the box so that it touches all the six sides of the enclosure, top, bottom, and the four sides. Look here, now we have proved our case. So your God can't be like this. Because, see, can you say an enclosure housing an item which is in contact with all the six edges, six length and breadth of that box? If God is going to be this, are you saying this is God? So what happens to your logic of trying to prove God is all pervading? So this was the second logical question which any young mind will put to us. So he cites this example only to discard it, to say, look here, young mind, it's true that it touches all over the frame, wooden frame. It touches the interiors of the wooden frame and not the exteriors, number one. Number two, this enclosure does not touch every element or particle within that boxed item itself. For example, there is an iron bureau where we go and keep jewels inside it. So the jewels are boxed completely. But can we therefore say jewels have enveloped the entire goblet bureau? Is there space sufficient enough to keep something else into it? The answer simply is yes. So if you go by the occupational theory with material examples cited, the constraint will be it may touch all the edges in the interiors but not the exteriors, and the wooden plank, the wooden enclosure doesn't penetrate to the inner core of that item which it seeks to enclose. So it is not contained, it is not all pervading, it simply touches. What does the Lord say? We cited the shloka from the 12th chapter, I am an enclosure of. So if you go by the enclosure theory of a human understanding in the material world, no, it doesn't work out. So therefore he cites chapter 11, shloka 20. This interval between the earth and the heaven is occupied by you alone. So are all the quarters. This is the declaration Bhagavan Sri Krishna conveys to Arjuna and through Arjuna to all of us. There is not an atom or an iota of space in which I am unavailable. So the second logic of occupational theory also fails because it is not all pervading. Now he takes the third example, the third step. Can we say, see, you are saying something should touch the exterior, something should touch the interior. Suppose we bring something which touches the exterior and the interior, we can still fail. It may touch the interior, it may touch the exterior, but what happens? Because it cannot permeate through. So it is still not all pervading. So he gets over it with an example. There is a light. A light glows. And over the light, over the lamp, you have also a glass dome. This is the third stage. So you have a glass dome and a light glows. So the reflection of the light hits the interior parts of the globe all around without a mistake. It also permeates and flows through the dome. And therefore, the light glows also on the exteriors of the dome and travels beyond it. So the counter given by logicians or you are saying God permeates, God is all, look here, we are giving you an example. So will you say this lamp is God? Because lamp glows, touches all the interiors of the dome, touches all the exteriors of the dome, and also permeates through the dome. So inner, outer, and permeation, all the three happens. Because what does the Lord say? He says in chapter 15, the light which inheres in the sun and enlightens all the world, the light in the moon and the light in the fire, know that all that the light is mine. So when Krishna says, look at this, how is he right? Because we are showing you a lamp can do that. A man created, human created lamp can do this. It can permeate, it can be inner, it can be outer. So can we therefore say lamp is God? It's all pervading. So what happens to your logic? The author goes to prove that this example should also fail. Because simple reason, very simple reason, you switch off the lamp. What happens to the radiance? What happens to the light? It no longer reflects on the interiors and the exteriors, nor does it permeate through the room. So what does it mean? If it is all pervading, the light having pervaded the dome should be now part of the dome. The dome should glow even when the lamp is switched off. Only then it is all pervading. Otherwise it is not all pervading. Because Krishna's words are truth. God's words are truth, and whatever God speaks becomes truth. That's the logic of this dharma. So, taking the third step of inner, outer, and permeation, the light doesn't get deposited once and for all in the dome, so that when you switch off, it continues to glow. And therefore, you can't take this as an example to prove that God is all pervading. So this illustration also fails. Now go to the fourth. Hey, come on, yaar, what are you asking for? You are only saying permeation is not acceptable. Now we will show you examples. Interfusion. What do you mean by interfusion? You have a wire gauze, or else you have a metal gauze, which is porous in nature. So when you allow water to flow through the wire gauze, allow water to flow through the metal gauze, what happens? Three things happen. It touches all the interior, it touches all the exterior, and it also travels through the gauze. So the flow remains unstoppable. Let's take the second illustration in this example. You have a cloth, and a cloth which is white in color. You use multiple colors in various parts of the cloth and interfuse it with those colors, green, yellow, blue, whatever, choice, rose. So what happens? The color gets clearly embedded over it, beneath it, and also through the interfaces of each string at the top. So you find cloth to be completely embedded. You are, whatever you want, we are proving. You want something to be on the exterior, something to be on the interior, something which passes through it and also remains embedded. Look here. So can you say this cloth is God? Does it survive that test? Is your God so simple? Now let's take even a superior example than this. Let's take sugar or salt and dissolve it completely in water. Completely dissolved. One, a dissolved sugar and a dissolved salt in the water, you cannot figure the salt and sugar thereafter. The process of dissolution, it's complete. Now you can easily strike back using your logic to say, hey, what are you saying? God is all pervading. Look at this salt, pan of salt water, a bottle of salt water. I drop salt into it and then it dissolves into it. Now this dissolution is complete. No interior, no exterior, no interfusion. It is there in every particle of water. This example is quite stunning. Look at, please remember, this dharma of this nation is not simply faiths and beliefs which logicians and rational mind very easily branded as superstitions. This dharma is not that alone. It forms the basis as how a child has faith in its mother. Can you explain it? Can any scientific experiment in a laboratory explain that feeling? It is so inherent and natural. Likewise, faiths and beliefs enshrined through this dharma of this nation, when practiced with absolute integrity and faith to to the letter and spirit of what has been commanded, through proper guidance of a guru, will logically take you one day to this inquiry. If you say, I won't take the first step because I have problems in your superstitious beliefs, then you are a non-starter. You are outside the stadium. How can you watch the match? And when you're outside the stadium, what right and authority do you have to command and to say that there is no match going inside? This is the problem. A probing mind has to accept certain rules. So the probing mind, which now this is all, see how logically it is true. Because you want, this talk is not about faith and beliefs, which are equally, if not more important. But this talk to a young mind is to only convince you, application of a rational mind to prove how God is all pervading. So through this fourth example, Three illustrations have been shown, namely water passing through the gauze, chemicals being, dyes being put, embedded via cloth, and water completely dissolved. Why? Because these examples, because they cite the same shlokas. They say, this is what your Bhagavan says, chapter 7, shloka 7. All this is threaded in me as the precious stones in mystery. Yeah. I've left out one more example. So we have taken salt, we have taken the cloth. Then the third, after all, you want something to pierce. So let's take a pack of pearls. And let's allow a thread to pass through it and form a necklace. Look here. Here is a thread which connects and makes a complete necklace. So, as per these three examples, we have proved the logic or theory of interfusion. So, you have a necklace, a dyed cloth, and a pan of salt water completely dissolved. Can this be the right example to derive a logic God is all pervading? They can't be the right example. Why? Why? Because people who propone dharma gives a counter and explanation to it. Look here. When you say a string and a pack of pearls together form a necklace, there are two ways of unbundling it. Remove the string, the pearls come out as individual knots. Or remove the pearls from the string comes out as a separate item. So, end of the day, when you unbundle it, you have a string which is independent and separate, and a handful of pearls which is independent and separate. So, even though there is an interfusion, they have not become one. They have not merged into an indivisible part. They can be divided. And they can be divided either because of the string or because of the pearls. Take the case of dye, the dyed cloth. Start rinsing it through application of proper chemicals. You can get back the cloth almost its original form and shape. And the chemicals can simply be drained out. So even though it is embedded, it is capable of being separated. Same is the case of salt water. How do we generate salt? We generate salt only out of salt water. The process is so well known and practiced all over the world. So you can always separate salt from water, even though salt gets totally dissolved in water. So you are left with two components in these types of illustration. So what does it mean? If God is all pervading, you can't say God is someone who is all pervading but still leaves some residue somewhere. The logic won't work. This example or an illustration can't be summed. When we say all pervading, nothing should exist after that. When we say all pervading, he alone should exist. Whereas these examples show us two separate independent bundles. When you unbundle them, it becomes two. And therefore, this also do not derive or prove the logic or the statement declared by Bhagavan Sri Krishna in chapter 10, sloka 39. No being, animate or inanimate, exists which is without me. Doesn't prove the statement. So the fourth illustration again doesn't take us anywhere. Now we go to the fifth stage, imparting existence or partial pervading, which is what I explained, the process of unbundling. A necklace, we talked about necklace as the first example. A necklace remains a necklace for two reasons. It is a necklace because it is stuck to a string. It is a necklace because it contains a set of beads. So you can define necklace in two ways. It becomes a necklace because it is hung to a thread. It is threaded. Or because it has pearls which is threaded. A colored cloth is because it is having a base material called cloth and dyed material chemicals over it in the form of various colors. a salt dissolved water again has a salt pervade. So you have two components which are equally pervading. Suppose you are going to apply the logic at the fifth step. See, equally pervading. So can we say, can we accept the fact God is somebody who pervades on this universe, and equally this universe, this material world pervades on God? Is this logic acceptable? Is it fine to cite this as an example to prove or to disprove? Both ways. Somebody can say, look at your God is saying this statement. So it pervades means this material world can pervade on God and God can pervade. Then it is not all pervading. The expression all signifies all over, and nothing else. We have to go to that level of proof to persuade a young mind to say God alone exists. So this mutual pervasion results in unbundling, which is what we saw at step 4. And in step 5, if you're going to call this as a pervasion, this, if it pervades, both pervades equally against each other. And therefore, that is not a ground or a logic to prove God pervades over the universe and universe pervades over God. Unacceptable. Then the statement all pervading goes for a toss. We now go to the sixth step. The sixth step, we call it as the substratum test. And two examples are taken. It is so normal when we walk on the road in stray villages in the forest or in semi-darkness. It's quite possible for us to mistake a rope lying on the road as a snake. This mistaken identity is something so natural to the human mind. Anybody will accept it. So, a rope which is lying on the road is so easily mistaken as a snake. A young child walks out of its house, walks into the streets which is semi-lit or semi-darkness, finds a pole like a stump. A child of 4 or 5 years old is bound to assume, is this a thief standing to threaten me? So let's take these two illustrations. It is so common to mistake a rope as a snake, and it is not uncommon to mistake a stump or a half lamppost as a thief. Some solid structure of 6 feet in semi-darkness is assumed as a thief. Let's take this example. Now, ask these following questions to yourself. Does the snake and thief have an independent existence? You will say no, because that's not real. So the first point which we now try to impart or persuade in your mind's eye: you have a mistaken impression of a snake and a mistaken impression of a thief. Okay. Who lends credence to that mistaken impression? Something has to be there for you to mistake. So in the case of a snake, there is an underlying rope. And in the case of a thief, there is an underlying post. So it lends credence. But look at the magic. Look at the magic. Go only by logic. You don't have to agree if you are wrong. You can cite, no, this is right, wrong at this step. You're free to point out. These have been tested and proved for millions of years and for thousands of yugas. These are all examples which have stood the time-tested examples. So let's go to the next stage. Look at this magic. What is in reality is a rope. So the form in reality is a rope. But the form which the human mind imagines it to be a snake over it. So rope lends the form, but it only lends the form. The superimposition of your imagination that it is a snake doesn't flow from the rope. The rope is not a snake, nor does rope contain the snake. So that is our imagination. The mind imagines, looking at the form in that semi-darkness, assumes it to be a snake. So here is a case. You have a rope in reality, but you perceive a snake over it. And the perversion is total and complete. How do you say total and complete? You are able to see a snake and not a rope. Till such time, somebody proves it to you, oh, this is a mad mind. Look at this. This is nothing but a rope and not a snake. Till such time, you disfigure. Till such time, you understand that this is not a snake but a rope. It is your mind which keeps imposing on that real form called rope a snake. So you impose. Two, when somebody shows it to you, oh, look here, this is not a rope but a snake, and you realize that this is nothing but a rope and take it on your hand and handle it. The impression which you imposed on the rope as a snake disappears. Instantaneously it disappears. Does it not? So your imposition is your mind, and the disappearance that happens also happens in your mind, and what remains intact is a rope. Now let's take this example further. We have to take it to logical, rational proof. That's what young minds want. So let us take it logically further. So we are putting two questions to you. Where is the snake and where is the thief? It's the first question. You answer it. So what will you say? Come on. The snake is on the rope. The thief is on the lamppost. Please, you are all brilliant young minds, logical thinkers. Ask the question, is this answer logically right? Is it not an absurd answer? Is the answer a correct answer or an absurd answer? If you say the snake is in the rope, it's absurd. If you say the thief is on the lamppost, absurd. So Are we to derive your answer to be absurd or to give life and truth to your answer? No, no, no. The snake was in existence into the rope and it suddenly vanished somewhere. Can you say that? Can you give such an expression to this example and illustration? So what happens in reality is, till such time your mind assumes a notional form called snake and imposes it on the rope, or the child assumes a thief and imposes it on the lamppost, this state or condition of the mind is called the seeming condition. It seems to be a snake. It seems to be a thief. Till such time, you really understand it is nothing but a lamppost and nothing but a rope. So it is seeming, number one. Number two, it is not only seeming, it is only in the passing. These moments of understanding, these moments of reflection in your mind, in your thought process, is momentary. Momentary. Till such time you realize that this is wrong. So this superimposition is transient, impermanent, and momentary. And superimposed by our minds. All these four are correct or wrong. You ask yourself. If you agree that this is nothing but a superimposition, then the third derivative, if it is merely an imposition or a superimposition, then it doesn't become a part of the rope. A snake, which is imagined by you, cannot become part of the rope merely because you imagine this thing over it. A thief doesn't become part of the lamppost because merely because you imagine the thing. It is incapable. Everything is pure logic. We are only putting a logical analysis now. Clinical logical analysis. No faith, no belief. You are free to contest it. It's open for contest. No problem. So, mind imposes, and when it finds it is wrong, it disappears. So, imposition and disappearance is a matter of reality. Because it's an imposition and a disappear, followed by a disappearance, two, it is temporary, number one, and it doesn't become part of the reality. And number three, it becomes mutually exclusive. Why mutually exclusive? When you see the rope, you don't see the snake. When you see the snake, you don't see the rope. So, it is a mind game. It all flows from one's own mind and imagination. One's own mind and mind's experience and mind's capability of perception. What are we saying? What are all of us saying? Look here, I have a mind. I have an intellect. I am capable of perceiving. And therefore, I am not able to perceive God. Therefore, there is no God. Simple. If your perception travels only that far, you may be entitled to say on your own that, yeah, I am not able to see God is fair enough. But to declare a statement that there is no God, none of us have any right, absolutely no right. So in this example, what this illusion. What is illusory is the imagination that there is a snake over a road, the imagination that there is a thief over a lamp. No, let's apply that. No, we have to apply the logicians. Don't leave us there. So let us apply the converse. Can you apply the converse? What is the converse? Look here. It is the snake, imagine the snake, which transforms into a rope. Can you say that? No, no, no. It is actually a snake. It has now become a rope. No, no, it is actually a thief. He suddenly became a lamppost. Remember always, what is imagined is virtual and not real. And what is virtual cannot distract, disturb, deface, damage, deform, disfigure what is real. Can the imagined snake disfigure the rope? It can't. It is impossible. See, we see as we drive long drives on a summer, don't we see mirage appearing? Can it wet our vehicles? Can it drown our vehicles? Can it wet our feet ever in life? So, when something does not have its own existence, the logic which all of you will agree is it can't also pervade. An imaginary snake which has no real existence cannot be all pervading. The difference why I'm saying is in salt water, you can deform and take salt separately and water separately. In a necklace stuck in a thread, you can separate the threads and the beads separately. In a dyed cloth, you can take the chemical separately and the cloth separately. In an imagined superimposed snake, in an imagined superimposed thief, even if you disfigure, one becomes virtual imagination and the other becomes the virtual reality. And the pervasion is total, complete. And the pervasion is unilateral. It only pervades. The rope appears to be a snake. It is not the snake which appears to be a rope, because you don't transform a snake into it. What is an imagination? What is an illusion? Always remains in the realm of illusion. It doesn't transform into reality. Number one. Number two. What is always an illusion doesn't have the power to pervade into what is real. And therefore, believers of this Dharma in this nation keep preaching based on Bhagavad Gita and such superior text, which is common to the whole universe. God is all pervading. And this universe is a mere illusionary reflection. Whatever you imagine, in whatever form, you may say, what are you saying? Is this wall? Is this computer? Hey, imagination, I'm seeing it like you are. You are seeing it as you see a snake. Till such time you are in the realm of understanding this to be a snake over the rope, you can only see this whole universe and you cannot see God. And these sacred texts tells you how to eliminate this illusion out of your mind, out of your thought process. So the illusion gets drained, gets cleaned up. Then what remains, what alone remains is the reality. This whole universe then becomes an illusion to you. This is the sixth step. This is still not complete. There is still one more step left out. We'll complete in the next 10 minutes. The last seventh step is, see, there are some limitations in this snake over rope or a thief over lamp. There are some limitations, even in this example. Now, what are those limitations? See, there is a dissimilarity in the products or in the nature of forms. One is rope, another is snake. And the eclipse is so total that you are not able to see simultaneously both. And one happens in succession over the other. When you see the snake, you don't see the rope. When you see the rope, you don't see the snake. So one happens in succession. So for a young logical mind, this dharma seeks to prove the seventh step. I will give you an example and an illustration. See, all of us have, why are we in this world of duality? We are in this duality because we are constrained by three limitations. Limitation of space, limitation of time, and limitation of substance or cause. These are the three basic problems we suffer from. What do you mean by space? Whatever this body can occupy. This is the limitation of me. Therefore, confine, start analyzing you everything in terms of space. God means God should also be within the space. He can't be beyond the space. So he has to be within the confined space. We are constrained with our own time limitations. Our body clock has a time cycle. The universe has a time cycle. Everything has a time cycle. So we measure God. God is somebody who should be in this timetable. Only then he is acceptable to us as God. And cause or substance. So this dharma takes the seventh step, the final step, the clinching step to show. I will go show you an illustration which will prove to you more logically than even snake over the rope or the thief over the lamppost to say, this example will show God, who is all pervading, has no constraints of space, no constraints of time, and no constraints of substance. Okay, what is that example? The example is, take the case of gold, solid gold, melted and transformed into a chain. Gold transformed into a chain. Now let us apply the three tests. What are the three tests? The chain which we see is nothing but gold. Even though it appears as a chain. So the option is yours. Now it is your mind. For an ordinary human being, when he or she takes a chain, a gold chain on his or her hand, a lady wearing a gold chain will appear before, stand before the mirror, put different postures to see whether that chain suits her neck. She is more concerned about the form and shape of the gold chain. To her, it is the chain that is a matter of attraction. Now she takes this, she uses it for 10 years and she is fed up. She wants a different variety. So she goes to the jeweler and gives this chain. He says, this is such a lucky chain. It has such a big history. It has visited places you can't imagine. That jeweler will keep his hands on his head and when you say all this, to me this is gold. You want a change? Okay, I'll give you a better jewelry and let me take this stuff back. So for somebody who wears it, it is a chain. For a jeweler, it is simply a gold. So there is no constraint of space here, because the chain occupies, every atom of the chain is filled with gold. The river says the gold assumes in various forms, and today it's a chain, tomorrow it's a ring, day after tomorrow it can be a bangle, fourth day it can adorn a crown, it can take millions of forms, no problem. Whatever form it takes, it retains its essential character as a gold. So there is no space constraint. First test. Go to the second test. Look here. It was chain yesterday. It is bangle today. It is a crown day after tomorrow. But gold remains gold yesterday, today, and tomorrow. So when you talk of names and forms, it has constraints of time. The underlying gold has no such time constraints. It existed earlier to us. It exists through us. And it shall exist even thereafter us. Even after us. So there is no constraint of time. Now come to the third substance. For you, it is such a beautiful chain. So you are concerned about the chainness contained in that chain, the shape and form contained in that chain. But in substance and in reality, it is nothing but a gold in a particular form. Has the substance gold undergone any change, any depletion, any modulation? It remains gold intact forever. So it satisfies the substance test too. So space, time, and substance, which we are so used to in our analytics. The most superior brain in this world is constrained with these three limitations. Take it. You're all logicians. Am I right or wrong? So when this is the reality, and this is the truth, we are showing an example that, look here now, you translate this gold chain example into universe, and because we took universe, as I said, in these 2 days of talks, we're going to touch on universe and slightly touch on Jiva and cosmic before I conclude it tomorrow. Because today I've concentrated on the first part of universe, namely material objects, which are physical and tangible, to show God is all pervading these physical objects. That is what we took it as a statement 1 hour back. And we need to prove it. So the example gold and gold chain goes to show, in terms of any tangible, you can assume any tangible in this universe. It has form and name, which is temporary. It will come, it will go. But there is something which is inherently holding it. It assumes that shape for you and it disappears. It assumes, reappears, then disappears. Assumes another form and shape, appears and decays. But the gold remains intact forever. It was existing yesterday, it was existing today, and it shall exist tomorrow. So, can we therefore say there is somebody, God is someone who pervades time, pervades space, and remains the only substance, like a robe, like a lamppost, like gold. And whatever you see over it, here and there, see, can you, in your, you are making chain, you are making ring, you are making bangle, can you rearrange the gold in it? Can you touch it? Can you rearrange it? You destroy chain today and it will appear something else. Can you still the gold, the goldness in it? Can you rearrange it? Can you destroy it? So the reality remains the same. So can you now transpose this illustration to say, this whole universe which you see so materially beautiful, so voluminous, such a huge bandwidth, enormity, size, magnificence, amazing, unimaginable, is simply like a chain. Because the whole world, to whatever extent you can expand, is a creation of an illusion from your mind, which you superimpose it on the gold. Imagine it to be a chain. For us, for the maker, who is like a jeweler, is simply watching the fun. Oh my God, somebody says it is chain. Somebody says it is bangle. Somebody dances it with a crown over their head. It's nothing but gold. A Jivan Mukta, a realized soul who pursues this journey, finds ultimately whole thing is an illusion and God alone exists. Rest is nothing but a superimposition. So this first part of the lecture attempts to logically prove through 7 steps that whatever you see physically, tangibly, is nothing but a reflection, an illusion sprouting out of your mind as you mistakenly assume a rope to be a snake, assume a thief to be a lamppost to be a thief, or a gold chain to be nothing but a mere gold. So tomorrow, we will deal with the intangible part of the energy contained in it, because every structure in this world works in an order. If a lamp has to glow, if fire has to glow, if a rock has to be steadfast, if a pot has to remain in that shape as a pot, the potness in it, every creation with human effort in this world, who sustains it? You all think, my God, I created this. I did this. Nothing. He can't do anything. So there is an internal energy to attach to it in some form. If you want, if you take a good sweet, oh, how delicious is it? That taste comes from where? Who gives you the ability to taste? Hearing such a great music, who gives you the ability to hear? These are all intangibles. Taste is intangible. Hearing sensation is intangible. Touch is intangible. So there is some controller within you who gives you this experience. When it goes through the mouth, it gives you the sense of taste. When it flows through the ears, it gives you the sense of hearing. When you touch a small child, don't you feel like touching a feather? So who gives that intangible feeling and experience to you? That will be the second part. First part is on the tangible part. The second part will be the energy or the intangible part. Put together by tomorrow evening, we will be able to logically prove in your mind, God is all pervading. And God alone is all pervading. Rest of them is our own creation, arising out of our human imagination.
Sadashiva samarambam Shankaracharya madhyamam asmat acharya paryantam vande guru paramparam. I place this talk at the lotus feet of Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam Jagadguru Shri Madhavinav Vidyatheetha Mahaswamigal, Mahasannidhanam Jagadguru Shri Shri Bharatheetheetha Mahaswamigal, and Sannidhanam Jagadguru Shri Shri Vidushekara Bharati Swami. And offer my humble pranams to my Manasika Vedanta Guru, Jnananda Bharati Swamigal, whose Jayanti celebration part 1 is complete today.
Let's meet tomorrow at 6 p.m. same time. Namaste.